Hello, everybody, and thank you for coming to Deb Chanel's 48's World, where we do recaps and reviews on soap operas and reality shows and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
She back on camera, y'all.
Okay, I haven't been feeling my best. My allergies have been, like, totally wearing me out. I can't take it, so I find comfort into giving you all visuals as well as my voice and my commentary. But for some strange reason, everybody knows me in a sense, because you know I started out talking with y'all live and in charge, and you know y'all getting my comments and goings, all my facial expressions, all my hand gestures, and this, that, and the other. Okay, but I had one subscriber who liked it, my reviews I did on my soap operas, and she wanted to just see me interacting on camera. So I was like, okay, I can do it this time. But usually I'm, you know, like I said, I'm not really well enough where I feel comfortable being out here in a hat all the time, you know, because it seemed like, you know, I need to be looking, you know, a little bit prettier for you all. But I just really haven't been feeling my best, because it seems like when the pollen counts are real high, I tend to, you know, be somewhat, what do you call it, out of sorts in a sense, because everything seems like it's going up my nose, the pollen's itching, my throat scratching, and all of that. And then it seems like when the pollen count is low, like in their 300s or lower, to doggone non-existent, I guess you can say, I get real sick, you know, with it. And it's like the pressure, barometric pressure goes down or something, and I have, you know, headaches, migraines, and that's just how I've been feeling for the last couple of weeks. So that's why, and I've been, you know, not ODing, but pretty much, you know, taking all my allergy medicines and stuff, and it gets me drowsy, and I tend to yawn a lot. So I just really haven't been wanting to get dolled up, you know, looking decent for you all, because I don't want to give y'all no bad part of me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't get dressed up for the camera or be presentable. I'm just going to be me either way. But it just takes a lot to try to prepare yourself, put your lipstick on, put your, you know, get your face right and tight. And, you know, I like showing my natural hair, but right now I'm just not feeling my natural hair either. So, and I kind of like the visuals, because it's like I see what I see after I review the show. And then I try to give you all, for who haven't seen, you know, the show in its entirety or at all, I want to give you like little clips of what I'm talking about. So that's why I chose to do the more imagery visual than me being on camera. Even though I know some people like to see me cut up. That's why I say, please go check me and my daughter out, because she refused to have me on camera with her if I'm not on camera. She's not with this visual stuff. Well, she can do both things, where she has a little bit of visual for, well, she likes to be totally visualized with you, where you're interacting with her in a sense, where you're seeing her expressions and how she feels about things and this, that, and other. Like if y'all were really together and things just transpired amongst you both. She likes that interaction. And I like both of them, but I prefer to sometimes do visuals more so than me just being on camera with y'all talking, because I really do talk in excess. What could have been like a 20, 30 minute video, it'll be an hour. But some people still like to see me talk and carry on, even if they have to watch it in different segments. But I'm doing this for Angela, so I hope I won't give out her last name, because I don't want to, you know, throw people out like that I really don't know. I haven't really talked to or dialogued with, you know, long enough to build up some type of rapport, or I haven't really, like, talked with her on the phone, so cell phone. So I'm just going to go on into this episode of The Young and the Restless. It aired on Thursday, this past Thursday, April 21st, 2016 at 3 o'clock. Okay, we go right on into it. It's saying, well, let me just give you a little bit of background here. Nikki clashes with Sharon. Victoria confides in Nick. Chelsea makes Adam an offer he cannot refuse. And it just is what it is. That's the summary they have for this particular episode. So let's get right on into it. Ashley. See, I cover too many things, so I might speak out a name out of turn, but y'all know where I'm going with it. If y'all been following me, y'all know who I'm talking about and where I'm going with it, okay? All right, let's keep it moving. Recapping from that the previous episode, as we know, Miss Abby was coming down to partake a part of her baby shower that is allegedly a surprise. But I'm pretty sure, you know, women have intuition. We know when something's springing up on us. We know where we're going with it here and there. So she comes down and she wanted to wear these pretty kind of high heels. Now, you know, with being pregnant, we want to take everything safe and cautious. But sometimes some women want to still be able to conform to their pregnancy, but they still want to be able to transform into other things. You know, they still want to be acting like they don't have another person living with them. They want to be footless and fancy free, but she wasn't trying to actually endanger herself or her baby. She just wanted to be fashionable in these little heels that she bought. So she put them on, even though I guess I don't remember, but maybe it was some talk about she didn't need to wear those high heels. She needed to, you know, do traditional, wear some flats, some comfort shoes, and all of this measures that you take when you're pregnant. So she didn't heed any warning. And so crazy ass demon ass Max, and I already done set her up from the get go. He just got some kind of wire that you would use to, I guess, entrap something or to secure something if you're building a particular apparatus or whatever. Say we were building a fence and we needed that to secure it to stay up. You would use this type of metal string wire that's... Now you can take it off. That's pretty durable. And he just went on to set him up a little trap for Miss Abby that she would fall. He knew she would lose the baby. She would hurt herself. She would be injured because we're talking about coming down a flight of stairs. You know what I'm saying? They curve, you know, and like, but you really don't have anything to catch a hold of, especially if you're coming down in the center of this foyer and, you know, what you call stairway. Oh, well. And that little joke, I told you, see, Satan, honey, he deceived us. Say, where did he get him from? I don't know. Why they didn't do background checks or anything of that nature? I mean, yes, he was your child, Ben, but come on. Were you really keeping in touch with him? Were you really doing your due diligence as a dad, Skyping, going to parent conferences? You know, something. You know what I'm saying? Because just to bring this entity in here and he's just cutting up all around. Who? What were you thinking, Ben? What were you thinking? But anyway, that's neither here nor there. We keep moving on. Ashley, I'm not Ashley. I told you, I'm saying same people, same thing. But yeah, okay. But anyway, she comes down. She starts to wobble, wobble, fall, blunk, 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 blunk. What, you know, that's where it went. And then she's like, oh, she got knocked unconscious for a minute. And everybody sees, hears, come running. They're surrounded by her. Abby's mom is there. Ashley's there trying to keep her calm, trying to figure out what the hell happened. Then you got Ben, you know, trying to ask her questions, trying to get her to come back to them. Because, you know, kind of knocked her out and she fell flat. She went tomma, tomma, boom, boom, boom. And then she went flat on her stomach. So, you know, that's kind of traumatizing, you know. Hell, if it wasn't traumatizing for her, it definitely was for the baby. So, in essence, she just laid there, kind of, you know, thrown off her track of thinking and all of that. Of course, you would if you fell down a flight of steps. And she's just saying, you know, whispering, talking low that when everybody's asking her how she's doing, you know, is she okay? She's like, yeah, but the baby, is something wrong with the baby. So she knew that she landed pretty hard. And I guess it's a mother's intuition that, you know, when something is just not right. And so, you know, everybody's surrounded by her, trying to ask her little questions to keep her calm and try to ascertain the damages that may have been done to her internally. And, you know, if she can feel anything, you know, the little norms, they drills they give you to ask certain victims when they partake into something detrimental. And so somebody's calling 911. Somebody's assuring that she's comfortable, telling her not to move, this, that, and the other. You know, of course, her husband is there being dutifully receptive and, you know, trying to keep her at ease. And, you know, he's asking how she feels and she just saying, you know, she's the baby. So we move on from there. We go to Victoria and Nicholas. They're at her office going over business matters, and she do know that she need to hurry up and kind of get things going with them, because she needs to go to the baby shower and stuff. So he's like, okay, what are you talking about? Introducing to the board of directors as a new product that you want to brand. So she goes on, give him a little spill of everything, and basically goes over this incubator type apparatus that they're trying to get approved so they can implement it and make revenue for Newman Enterprises, which is a great thing, and it's a conscious thing for babies. You know, we're never going to have lacks of them, because everybody likes to procreate. And I mean, reproducing or whatnot. And he's like, well, okay, I see where you're going. I think it's gonna be a good idea. Okay. Well, let me just go on and pitch it and call the people. You go on and do what you got to do with the baby shower. I know that's something you really want to get to, and something that's true to form, because you're a mother and you want to go support our sister. And so, okay. I feel you. So why don't you go on, do what you got to do with the baby shower. I'll sit here and make some cold calls to some important people, introduce your ideal over the phone, answer any questions or concerns they may have with the branding of the product, and I'll see you later. And I'll forward you any information, or forward them any information they may need to be able to visually see what we're talking about, what we want to bring to them as new revenue for the Newman Enterprises. And you know, I thought that was a good big brother move, you know, thinking of her well-being and wanting to be sociable and be there for her sister, as well as still holding the company down and the family down when it came to the revenue. So kudos, Mr. Nick. So we leave on from there. We go to Chelsea and Adam. Adam has gone back home telling his wife Chelsea, what a bastard, what a just a unhappy person that father is, or his father is. And he didn't admit to me that, hey, I wasn't good enough to, you know, stay there and make the big moves and the big plans and, you know, run things while you're still stuck in jail. You're going to oust me out for whatever reason, because what? Of a passkey or some minimal exposure, or just because I didn't bow down to Victor Newman. You know, he's just going all tit for tat with him. And, you know, Victor looking at him like he crazy. He said, I didn't have nothing to do with you losing your job. You getting fired, if that's what you're saying. And he's like, you should do that. Cut it out. You know where I'm going with this. Stop it. Just go and tell me, be a man about your business and your henchmen. You know you got rid of me. He's like, oh, okay. That's what you really believe? That's what you're trying to say to me? Rewind, let me tell you something about business etiquette 101. When things are happening, your business is kind of going through a little crunch phase, it's not producing the revenue that it needs to be reducing, you got to limit your overhead, nuts. Have you ever heard anything of downsizing? It's a way that you restructure your company. Yes, you have to tend to let some people go in the organization to be able to be fiscal responsible. Okay. Fiscal responsible. I know you learned that in management school. I know you learned that in economics 101. Get out of my face, okay? And then technically, no, I didn't want you there running. I gave you the chance to take my offer up. You refused to. So why are you coming to me now? Why are you coming to me now, Adam? You selfish son of a bitch. Okay, we move from there. Okay, and he's basically telling Chelsea, he had a bad time at the prison with his dad. His dad wouldn't admit to it. And so he's feeling sorry for himself, pretty much. But Adam, being a Newman, he don't give up. He don't give up. He's going to work his way back in that company somewhere, somehow. It's going to come a way where he's going to get back in there. But Chelsea's like, okay, look, I know you are used to working for $1 million+ yearly, but hey, I have a need of a CEO of in marketing, branding, you know, my new company, or, you know, changeover company. Because, yes, Victor stole my company as well. But Chelsea 2.0 apparel, this, that, and the other, needs your creativity-ness and your skills, as well as your knowledge in the business aspect. Could you please come work for me? I would love it that we would spend more time with each other, da-da-dee, da-da-da. Can you do it for me? Now, people, imagine this. She's trying to pull her husband up by his bootstraps to let him know he's still valuable in the business industry. Yes, it's at a lower scale, much, much lower scale than what he's used to, and he's attained his education as well as his work behavior ethics, you know, on just viewing it from that standpoint that he sets his standards on. You can catapult Chelsea 2.0 to the same level, okay? One day. We can be up there like Newman Enterprises and all its other entities that it partakes of and it holds. We can make it happen, okay? We can outshine, outdo, and we're still considered Newman. So, hey, a friendly competition, let's take it. Come on, work for me. It'd be a family type thing. And it's still family. You see what I'm saying? Can we talk about it? So Adam is like reluctantly hearing the proposal, but he know he don't want to be idle either. So he takes her up on her offer. He sees it as a pity opportunity to save face. But he goes on and, you know, he says, okay, I'm fine. We'll do this to Chelsea 2.0. We'll see where I can take it. Put it on my resume. But anyway, we move from there. We go to Sage and Sharon. Both women are going over information that they have come to have privy information on when it comes to Dr. Anderson and Nurse Angela. They try to go and Google this, that, and the other, all the comings and goings on the nurse, Angela, I think it's Stevenson or Stevens. And, you know, unless you have a lot of more pertinent information you can put into that Google search, it's going to pretty much only give you basic stuff. And then if you, from what I've tend to have done in the past, when I wanted to play a little investigation on some things or someone or whatever, they always want you to pay something to be able to access something, you know, else. So just putting in a search, you may come up, by the grace of God, on some pertinent information on a person from just minute of information that you're giving the search in your search bar when you're trying to find out about a particular thing or person, and you may get a hit that way. And sometimes you have to go a little bit deeper and spend money out. Either way, these are what the two ladies were trying to do, and they weren't really coming up with what they needed. You know, they were just getting like an appetizer, but they really needed the meat and bread, you know, the carbs and the protein to make them be stable enough to take it to that next day, if you have can visualize that. So of course, you know, Sharon has a methodical mind, and she knows that her husband works for the police station. He's privy to other entities of getting information, private information, and good research information that she needs. She has the key. Why does she have the key? I have no idea why Dylan would give or leave this information around Miss Sharon, his wife. But for some reason, and he's going to rectify that situation after it all unfolds and transpires, for the negative or for the good. You know, Sharon should not be taking stuff that's not hers, or at least telling him about it. And then she still wouldn't have access to be able to, she wouldn't morally should be given that information, because she's not on payroll with their particular county or state, city of Genoa City, to have those type of access. She's not given that authority or authorization to have knowledge of that privy information. You see where I'm going with this? So she's just using like, okay, he's my husband. He has this type of resource. I'm going to use it, but I'm not going to tell him about it, but I'm still going to get my results. Okay. Nice, nasty, somewhat good, bad. Let it chips fall where they may. Okay. That's how we're going to play that. So while they're still conspiring against one another, Dylan walks in with his mom, Nikki. Okay. Now you remember he got a phone call early on in that day about his mom from a fellow colleague that she got hurt. Or she got clipped by a driver because she wandered out in the street. What made her wander out in the street? Go figure. Well, let me tell you. Alcohol. Yes, Nikki done fell off the wagon. Yep. Hey, life happens. Okay, she was a sober for X amount of years. She broke her sobriety. Why did she break her sobriety? Emotionally attached. Who is she emotionally attached to? Victor Newman. Did she not betray Victor Newman in a court case? Did he not refuse to see her when she went up to see him on their anniversary? We know it was tainted by the security guard. So, but all their whole longevity of the comings and goings, the ins and outs that they both have been a part of within their relationship, you would know, just as a clue, keep hope alive. Okay, because both of them are coming back for each other every single time. It's just, that's the way it is. So, but she took it to heart. He didn't want to see her on their anniversary. And, you know, after Jack had pulled some boss moves, got, you know, called in some favors, got her the opportunity to see him. The guard lied. He never asked Victor about seeing his wife. And so it was a moot point. She's thinking some kind of way, feeling some kind of way. He's thinking some kind of way, feeling some kind of way. So, to enough to be said about that, she started drinking. So, you know, she wasn't being truthful when Dylan tried to call her and just ask over the phone, hey, mom, what's going on with you? So, she wasn't being truthful. So, he's like, okay, I know how to fix you. I'm going to come see you. So, he left Sage with the baby because he had to go out and tend to some business. So he did. The business was going over to see his mom at the athletic club in her little private suite. Why she was there, I have no idea. I have no idea. Because she has a big, gorgeous house, but I guess it brings back too many memories and she just don't want to be by herself in that big house. So I understood that. If she got the room that she or suite that she normally partakes of when she's in town. Because she does live in the country areas far out, and she was in the city at the time, you know, doing the comes and goings with Victor's trial, him being put in jail. She wanted to be near to him. That was just almost like being in New York. You have a house way out in the suburbs, and then say you want to be in town because you're doing business, you will just have an apartment in Manhattan somewhere around the, you know, comes and goings scenery area. Of New York, the heart of New York. So you just have something in town where you don't have to be going back and forth, you know, traveling too much. So she has a suite at the athletic club at Genoa City. So she felt it, you know, more personable to just stay there than to go out and have no interaction in the country, because she didn't care too much for her daughter-in-law, who's actually on their same property, but it just have too many bad memories for her right now to be dealing with. So that's why she decided, I guess, to stay at the athletic club. But Dylan just, you know, went over there, told her to open up this here door. He went to see his mother. He found, you know, she finally half-heartedly opens up the door, comes with this blank, you know, ghostly look, like she death warmed over on her behind. And he was like wanting to fall to the floor, like, baby, you my mama, you supposed to come and, you know, let me help you. You know, I am grown, I'm solidified with resources, I'm the officer of the law. Why are you not leaning on me? Why are you not telling me, hush, Elijah, go lay down or whatever, okay, going upstairs, thank you. I ain't got nothing now. But anyway, do you want to whoop it? So, see, that's why I want to be off camera, too. Because, you know, my household is just too busy and whatever. But we're going to move on over there. We're going to move on. We're going to just ignore him. And we're going to continue to move on. What are we doing here? Where we at? Las Vegas Church. Okay, we're bringing Nikki home. So, Sage and Sharon were still going over the comings and goings of what they need to do for their little private investigation, little task they're taking on. And little Dylan comes on down the road, comes on down, you know, the little house track or walkway. He opens the door, let his mother walk in, and they just there looking like two Cheshire cats. And, of course, him and his wife, well, his wife and his friend, looking at him like he don't, you know, stole something. Because Sharon looked like she wanted to be, because she's trying to say, why is she here? Why is she up in my house? It's not a holiday. Nobody's sick or died. Why is she here? Okay. So, they both having the same attitude. Nikki looking at her like, why am I here in this lady's house I do not care for? She tried to burn down my mansion. She don't mess up with one of my sons. now she done got the other one in her claws. Done married to both my sons, been treating them wrong. God damn it, I don't want to be him either. Shit, let me just turn back around. Let's do a retake, rewind, and Dylan said, uh-uh. Let's just put y'all both on pause. Press pause, both of you all. Okay? He's dealing like he got two convicts in his presence. That's how he dealing with it, y'all. That's how he dealing with it. Whew. So they had to take a little wassa moment. Or wassa, whatever you call it. Wassa. But, you know, let's meditate for a moment. Okay? Let's take all the barriers down. Let's calm it down. Okay, we're calming it down and everything. Talking on even keel. He said, look. And he's trying to throw her signs, you know, like, you know, trying to do the eye contact thing. Like, hey, mama don't fell out the wagon. I don't trust her. She almost got run over. Then she tried to tell the person that almost clipped her by mistake. And it wasn't their fault. It was Nick. And she just idly just upset, wandering out in a crowd or whatever. And it is what it is. So, where are we? Where are we and why? Just lost my train of thought, guys. Hold on. Ooh, I had some stuff in my throat too, guys. Okay, so he's explaining to his wife that his mother needs some help. He's willing to help her, and she is too. She just don't know it yet. She should be very aware of Nikki and her attitude, her personality, and her barriers. Because she was married to her first, well, I think, wait a minute, which one is the oldest? Okay, Dylan would be the oldest. So her youngest son, her second son, she was married to him also. So she knows, they know. They're like arch nemesis, you know. She's nitrogen, Nick is glycerin. Together, they will produce a bomb and it will blow up. Okay, that's where we're with this. Okay, but anyway, he said, look at him. I'm the man of the house. I want my mama here. If the shoe was on the other foot, I would welcome your mother, you know, whatnot. But she's going to stay here for a while. And that's just what it is. So y'all play nice, you know, be nice to each other. And that's where we're going. Because I want my baby, Sully, to experience more love than his little heart can handle. And it would just be very appropriate. I want everybody to be on one accord. That's what I said. That's what we're going to do. Any questions? So pretty much that's where it went. We go to commercial. We come back to Chelsea and Adam. Chelsea's telling Adam she needs someone to do her marketing for her business, and it will more than likely help her than he's just doing her a favor, if that's basically what she thought he was coming. She was coming with the offer of having him work as her CEO. And once he gets a hang of it, you know, they pretty much have to go look at a building or space that they're trying to host their site at for Chelsea 2.0, instead of working, you know, at this person's house, that person's house, whatever. Just have a neutral location where everybody can come in if they don't want to, or they can't work from home. They just have to come in for business, other business related issues, or I'm pretty sure they'll all still be working at home. But it'd be nice to have your clients to come in that you want to work with, to have a setting other than your home environment, because you don't want everybody to know where you stay, because if things go bad, they still know where you stay. They can come get do work on you and all. You don't want all that happening. So we understand why you need to have a business outside than your things you want to have, or let people have privy to when it comes to your personal space. All right, so we move on back from there. Because they're going to go look at little places, and they have one little place in mind to host their little business atmosphere setting at. And from what it seems, as the story goes on, it was a good thing. So we go to Dylan, Nikki, Sharon, and Sage again. Sharon is asking, is there something wrong with the main house? Because she's still trying to process why her mother-in-law is there in her doorway, talking about, you know, putting her luggage up somewhere in the environment or structure, family surrounding what she got going on, because one does not go with the other. Okay, so pretty much she just reiterating in her mind what the hell is wrong with the situation. So with her doing her little nice nasty shades at mother-in-law Nikki, Nikki goes back and say, well, at least my place is not torched, because Sharon was pretty much out of her mind way back in the heyday, and she ended up torching their main mansion, little ranch house up there, far, far, far up there on the land that she occupies as well. It's a tack house that they renovated to being, you know, another little studio apartment type home. So she like, you know, you get something wrong with the athletic club. You can't go there, you know, this, that, and the other. And so, you know, Nikki was kind of taking it personal, and Dylan was definitely taking it personal because he's like, no, I'll tell you about that later on, but my mom is going to stay here. Those are two valuable places she definitely can go, but guess what? She's going to stay here with me. So, you know, they make an eye contact with each other saying, nah, this ain't right. We're going to talk about this, but I ain't going to, you know, I'm not going to pry too much more into your life. But then he gets a phone call, and then Sage want to get on out of there because she's feeling the tension as well, because she was trying to listen for the dirt to why her mother-in-law was there too, because she's married to, well, that's her mother-in-law too, to tell you damn true, because she married to the other son, which is Nicholas. So, she was like, better you than me, because I don't want it in my house, you know what I'm saying, because I'm already going through some issues. But anyway, neither here or there. She rushes out to go work on the little investigative planning and snooping that her and Sharon is working on. And then, Dylan gets a phone call about the incident that happened to Abby. And so he has to rush over to the athletic club and then make a dash over to, I guess, this General City Memorial Hospital they are at. He has to go to place. So he tell his wife, hey, something came up. She's like, wait a minute. Put the brakes down. Okay, you done dropped this situation into my lap. You really not giving me any type of background information, but you want this to happen. That's the way it's going to happen. And I'm the little lady of the house, so I'm supposed to let it happen. Well, it doesn't work that way. Okay, I'm a breadwinner too. I do what I need to do. But guess what? I'm going to give you a pass this time because I know you're an officer of the law. You go do what you got to do. But you know what? We're going to have this conversation, young man. We're going to have it, okay? So he moses on out of there, tells them to be, you know, respectful of each other. And he dashes on out, do what he got to do. So, of course, they looking at each other like they ready to throw blows, you know? It's just, you know, it's one of those ideas, you know what I'm saying? They start having name calls and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, she trying to be the dutiful person and, you know, tries to feel things out on the lighter side. She goes on and welcomes her in the home. You know, Nikki takes her spot. Sharon takes her spot. And, you know, they just couldn't get it together, you know. I think Nikki wants to, she's tired and she's just tired of seeing. Well, okay, here, this is how we go with it. They both have a seat trying to figure each other out. Sharon trying to make light conversation. She tells her, look, I'm working with Chelsea now. Chelsea, you know, her company 2.0 and this, that, and the other. Before Nikki could let her even get halfway finished with the sentence, she interrupts her and say, okay, why are you doing that? Don't you think your duties will be very much well served with your newborn baby that you got here? Like, I'm discounting what you're saying because you don't had your career thing. You done did this, you know, many, many times with my other son. Okay. See where I'm going with this? So I'm not taking it lightly that you want to have a career when you should be raising your family. Hell, I did it. And my children turned out awesome. And they're running their father's company. So, again, don't act like you my best friend for life, my BFF, because we don't roll like that. All right? We just don't roll like that. And don't want to have any dealings with you. I'm only here because my oldest son, which is your husband, but I bore him into this world, wants me to be here. Okay? So they're sitting down the playing field and all that kind of stuff. So they have some little nice, nasty digs at one another, this, that, and the other. And not in this particular scene, but I'm going to give it to you because it's quite cute. I enjoyed it. They gave me my life of entertainment on the day I watched it. But since I'm a little behind, I'm getting it to you, but I'm still getting hyped about it. Hun, they go into calling each other names. Nikki calls Sharon a gold digger from the past. And probably still now because she's still, you know, leeching on and stuff. She's a fire starter. She goes on to tell Nikki she's a drunk. I mean, it was like all like pop call. Then Nikki gonna call her, she a kleptomaniac. You know, when Sharon had a little thing where she going around stealing folks' stuff. But she was kind of like having a, walking amnesia or something like that. sleepwalking mechanisms, messing up her brain and stuff. And then, she just called a bad mother. It was going tit for tat, and I was enjoying it because I know it was coming from a scene of misdirection, misguidedness, and it was just love. Everything was just encapsulated with love. And I was like, I'm here for it. Keep spilling. Then she called nigga a prostitute, a hoe, a man stealer. Just going on and on. It was just, it gave me my entertainment life. I'm telling you, it did. Thursday was wow. Friday was wow. You know, it was just crazy. But anyway, we go on. They get tired of each other and, what happens? I think she just goes on and lays down or something to that effect. Then we go back to Dylan and Sharon. We went past that. So let me move on there with my little notes here. Okay, we go back to the segment where we got Abby on the floor still. Dr. Neville went on and called the paramedics to be able to pick up Miss Abby and transport her to the hospital to find out what's going on with her. Miss Lily is having an epiphany that she has guests in the back still waiting on this baby shower to start. And I'm like, I don't understand. Let's stay way further back. Why they didn't hear the commotion? But anyway, she said, oh, let me go tell these people in the back about, you know, we have to cancel and reschedule, da 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 da, about this baby shower because it's definitely a no happening deal. So she goes and rush off. Then we go back to Ben and Ashley. They're still on the floor. And Abby's telling him everything. Well, he's pretty much telling Abby everything's going to be okay. Keep breathing normally she can. Don't have any anxiety. You know, the paramedics are coming and everything's going to be fine. Then we go to Kane and Max. Kane went over to talk to Max to see how he was doing. He was all like stone-faced. He really was like emotionless, kind of blank stone-faced, like, okay, why is she not dead? Why don't I see blood? You know, he's just like methodical. He's just still thinking intensely evil in his mind. And I'm pretty sure Kane feeling it all. He's feeling it all. That something ain't right with this young man. I'm telling you, Kane, demon, see, step back, honey. But anyway, we go on to Victoria. Victoria walks in. She sends all the activity around her, and that's negative. She's trying to figure out what the hell is going on. What did I miss now? I know I was running a little late, but goddamn, you know what I'm saying? What happened? Why is my sister on the floor? What is going on? So, here we go with this. All right. They go and tell her, well, she fell down. I don't know what happened. Somehow she tripped down, fell down the stairs. Now we're in this incident, as you can see. We're waiting for the paramedics to come and scoop her on up so we can take her to the hospital. So as she does come in, she's getting that little information. The paramedics do come. They pick her up, stroll her on out of there. And she goes on to call, Nicholas and stuff. But she's also going on to the hospital as well. So we move from there. We go to Sharon and Nikki. Nikki is screaming out because, like I said, she went and caught herself taking a nap because she was just sick of Sharon at the time. So it was just real funny. They go into battle number two. She comes out. She really is screaming or, you know, hollering out for Dylan because she's thinking he has come home or whatnot. But he's still not coming home. He's still over there at the athletic club trying to ascertain what happened in this and the other. And she finds Sharon. And, you know, Sharon's sitting there working on her computer. And, you know, she's just want to pick at her again. And Sharon's just pretty much telling her, you know, a good parent still can be able to have a life as well as working. Just balance between home life and work life. You can professionally do both. And, you know, Nick ain't hearing it. She ain't hearing it. And then so, now we know Nikki is a recovering alcoholic. We know she's already falling off the wagon and she's trying to get a hold of herself. She said, do you want a drink? And then Nikki just takes it, you know, for the wrong. Though I know it was some pun intended. But She like, how can you ask me that? You know, she like, no, honey. I'm talking about, do you want some tea or something? Then Nikki kind of, you know, calms down a little bit and like, no, I don't want anything from you, honey. I don't even want the air that you're breathing. Okay. So Sharon is still trying to make a little small talk, just trying to make a something good out of a bad situation, because neither one of them want to be there. That's just where it is. And, you know, again, basically, she don't want to be bothered with her, period. So, let's see. We go to Dylan and Nicholas. And he, wait a minute, he goes to see where we're trying Nicholas. Okay, he goes to basically see Nicholas or Victoria, one of them, because he's going over to the Newman Enterprises office complex. And as he's walking in, you know, he's saying, oh, well, Nikki should be on her way to the function if that's the reason why you're coming. He's like, no, I'm glad she's wanting to go and visit with our sister and her little baby shower. But no, what has happened is I'm coming to you about mom. Mom has fallen off the wagon. She was in a light accident yesterday and this, that, and the other. And Nicholas was like, dang, I ain't know it was that bad. You know, like he's totally consumed in his life, his marriage, and, you know, not even really concerned by his mom. But then to keep things intact, he has been a good son as well and always have looked out for his family, especially when it came to his sister as well as his mother. So he just got a lot on his plate as well. So he goes on and tell him, you know, hey, thanks for letting me know. But he gets he know he has to go two places, but he wanted to go that place first. And then he went on over to the General City, athletic club to pretty much see what was going on. But he just generally just stopped by to tell him that little bit of tea on their mother and see what he can do about it. Maybe they have to kind of share their mom between both residents. It's just not a good look for her to be by herself all the time and feeling, you know, kind of bad. So, you know, they go from there, do what they got to do there. Okay. So he leaves, and as he's leaving, Nicholas is getting a phone call from his sister saying that, hey, Abby has been in an accident. We're going over to General City Memorial, whatever you call their little hospital in their little state and city. And he's like, well, what happened? And then she's just giving him basic information because she didn't really get it all in one spiel. And he just said, you know, get to the hospital as soon as you can. So he's like, okay, I'm on my way. So he exited out. We go to Sage and Esther. Okay, we already told you that basically they were on their way to being investigative reporting, her and Sharon. So she's pretty much got to work her way around Esther without letting Esther know her true intentions of being there. So how she goes on getting Esther's attention, because she knows Esther's kind of a goofball, a Barney Fife, like on Mayberry. Similarity is what I'm trying to bring to you all. So she just gives her a compliment saying, you know, with this new hairstyle she has, she kind of favors her of this little rap star or big name known rap star that's in our generation now, called Nicki Minaj. And she's like, who is Nicki and who is Minaj? And I'm like, okay, whatever. So at least Esther had enough sense to try to Google her, because she eases on past Esther, because she's saying she got to get something out the office that she need to work on for Sharon. So, you know, she pays no attention to it because she's trying to figure out who this Nicki Minaj, what she looks like, you know, what kind of music she jams to, and can she get into her. So, you know, she got that award-winning prize for getting Esther to not think about why she really was here. So she went on, did what she got to do. Esther went on Googling, and we're going to go on to Max, which is the next scene. So Max is removing his wire after everything done transpired. They done transported Abby to the hospital. So he's doing his little cleanup work. Now, lo and behold, why they did, the writers didn't write a scene where somebody else came and they tripped down and went bum, 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 bum. You know what I'm saying? Downstairs. That would have been a good key to trap Max's ass, because I'm telling you, he's a demon seed. He's straight. He's Satan's son, because he just totally is mischievous. He just want to kick up somebody. And I truly think that they ain't gave us the tea of his mother. I think she was in Australia also, or somewhere far out, that she was keeping Max and raising him on her own. I really believe he killed her, but had some parts in it. But you know, Bex has kind of cleaned up for Seed of the Crab and all this. And Lily, you know, catches him. She goes over to find, you know, what he's doing. You know, what are you in the hall by yourself for? And he said, oh, I'm just trying to check the structure of everything because I think the carpet is loose and that may have caused Abby to fall downstairs. And then, of course, you know, Kane walks up from behind, kind of hears the conversation. And she was like, maybe could that have happened? And, you know, basically Kane was like, okay, we're going to check it out. But I really don't think that that's the issue. So, but it's just the thing that this little boy is thinking so methodically about, you know, first getting the evidence out of, you know, the way. So in case somebody want to come and investigate, they'll see this little wire that's been set up for potentially for somebody to fall. And they were looking for one particular person because, you know, nobody ain't going to set up something like that arbitrarily just to have people just falling, you know, every time they come up the stairs or down the stairs. You know, it ain't like that. So it was deemed for one person to get hurt, and that person happened to be Abby. So he was cleaning up the scene of the crime. So then we go to the hospital with Ben, Abby, and Ashley. And Abby is in the hospital getting her exam by the doctor. So she's conscious and everything. And they pretty much don't look like it's going to be no life-saving type techniques here. The baby is gone. The baby has been traumatized by falling down them steps and immediately landing heavily on the stomach area where the baby, you know, is being preserved in. So he didn't really want, the doctor came in doing the exam, and he didn't really want to be able to give a diagnosis of the problem prior to doing an ultrasound or x-ray. And so after he tends to do that, he kind of turns off the machine because there's no activity there. There's no baby there, you know, whatever. Or the baby has, you know, maybe, I don't know how a baby gets destroyed through that type of trauma, how they can actually see it. Or maybe it's just pulse, what do you call it? Energy that's coming through the x-ray machine that shows you whether something's still alive or something's just not, it's nothing there anymore, meaning death. So after giving that type of evaluation, and you know, he pretty much turns off the machine and be like, ain't no baby done, no mom, sorry, but we're gonna have to, you know, get her into emergency surgery so we can take out the placenta, which was, you know, what the baby was living in, and clean her up in there, and you know, let her go on and heal, get, you know, the recovery part started for. But then we go back to Ashley and Victoria. Ashley is telling Victoria, she, you know, loves the baby. She lost the baby, this, that, and that. She don't know what she's gonna do. You know, the whole goings and comings of trying to keep somebody their spirits up while they're going through a tragic time of their lives at the moment, but trying to get them from thinking of on the negatively things that are a negativity that's going on with them. They're trying to like transfer their thoughts to somewhere else that's more positive and more compassion is coming from that type of scenery and visual than, you know, have them thinking, you know, bad about the situation. There's nothing gonna come out of it good. So they were trying to keep the spirits up. And like I said, they already know the baby's left because the doctor's in there doing the examination, and he basically don't really tell her, but they know by, you know, the way he's responding to him, the body language that's going on. And then when he say that they have to, you know, do surgery on her, so they have to remove her from the room and go on and do the cleanup that's up in her body, meaning taking the baby out, discarding it, and this, that, and the other. But before that, she goes into her crying spell, everybody breaks down, and you know, it's just prayers need to be sent out at that time. And, you know, again, Ben is doing his due diligence by, you know, trying to tell her, you know, it happened for a reason. Don't blame yourself. We can have another baby. This, that, and that. But in his mind, he's thinking that, but he's not saying it to Ashley because he's grieving along with her. So we go to Sharon and Nikki. Nikki is, again, going off on Sharon. And same thing is transpiring, you know, amongst both women. And that's when they had gotten those, you know, calling each other names and stuff, you know, prostitute, piece of trash, a gold digger. I kind of gave y'all that information already. Kind of went ahead of myself. And Sage is at the hospital. She's doing her due diligence, finding information on, well, no, I'm not sorry. She's not at the hospital. She's getting all her information that warrants proceeding on to investigating Dr. Anderson as well as the nurse, Angela Stevens. She gets a lot of hits on Dylan's computer, which you know is not privy information, so they're breaking all kinds of laws that I'm sure, his wife is going to have to answer to. And okay, Chelsea and Adam has come to Crimson Lights and meeting. Well, they're just there pretty much, and they just see Sage working on Dylan's computer. But Chelsea confused it that she's working on some work for Chelsea 2.0 and whatnot. But she quickly, you know, closes the laptop and let her know, no, they ain't, this is the other person information I'm working on. But she knows she has to get that computer right back in the coffee shop office where Dylan does, you know, his work when he's there running the store or Crimson Lights. So she gets the information she needs to tell Nikki it's a green light. We need to go further because some stuff is popping off. We need to check out. So they basically do their pleasantries with one another. Adam and Chelsea with Sage, and then they disperse. She goes one way, they go out another way. Then we go back to Sage. We went through that part. We go back to the hospital with Kane, Max, and Lily. Max goes to tell, no, I'm sorry. Lily goes into, I pretty much went to there as well, told you all about that. But both of them are conspiring, but she's telling Max there's no way that could have happened the way he's saying it, because everything was already checked out through, you know, regular examinations on the building and the property. They do it regular, so no, there's no carpet coming up. And where are you getting all this information for anyway? You a small boy. You're supposed to be knowing all these specifics. Okay, I'm thinking something about you too. But anyway, Kane kind of hears what's going on and what is being said between the two. And he goes on and said, you know, Lily, go and look at those little tapes. Let me know what's going on. See what you can find. And, you know, I thought she was actually going to the room herself and evaluating. I'm like, why would she do that, Kane? Wouldn't that be your job? But anyway, she went and called their security company to back up the tapes around this particular time of the day and give her feedback of what they see. Or if it's something incriminating, it's somebody, you know, doing, you know, some work that they want us to be liable for, you know, just stuff of that nature. And then Demon Seed over there, he's hearing everything. He said, wait a minute, hold up, y'all got cameras around here. And then, you know, Lily and Kane go on to tell him, yeah, we got security cameras around the whole place. You know, we got cameras, okay? So he gets scared and like, I don't know what I'm going to do. Yeah, I bet you didn't know what you were going to do. But anyway, he was on the hot seat then, and we just moved there because his mind is still being meticulous and trying to, you know, see what damage he has to do. And I kind of thought about, oh, please don't let Lily be alone with him, because he'll probably try to throw her down some steps or stab her or something and pull her in the closet somewhere and hope nobody find her until he don't escape. But anyway, we move on to Dylan and Nikki. Dylan tries to ease back in without disturbing anyone. Nikki's sitting in some little chair that's facing away from the door, but she got good hearing. She could hear him coming in because she wasn't asleep. And, you know, basically he goes over to see, you know, how she's doing. He's checking on both women, but then he finds out that his wife is not there. No, I take that back. No, I'm thinking about another soap. He comes in the door. He sees his wife in the far corner, and he sees his mother on the other room, on the other side of the far corner. He's trying to figure out what the hell done happened. Okay, at least they didn't kill each other. At least that's a good thing. And where's his son? Is he trying to think? Because he's like, okay, we got two estranged women here, but I don't hear no crying. Hopefully my son is sleeping. And they, you know what I'm saying? So he's trying to ascertain the whole dynamics of the room before he even opens his mouth and say anything. Because he knows it's a tense. It's a cooker, a pressure cooker up in there. So, of course, she going to get her son. The mother gonna get her side, and he like, okay, the truth is here somewhere. So we go on and go and say he resolved the issue. But in the midst of all of that, he got another phone call about going to Crimson Lights, to go to a concern that happened at the athletic club, and that his sister was in the hospital, because he didn't know at the time. I thought he knew, but when I'm going and playing it back in my mind, he didn't know. But he go on and tell Sharon a little bit about it, because Nikki don't excuse herself again, because she refused to be in any room situation with Sharon, especially she don't have to. But when he got the phone call saying that he needed to get to the hospital and check out the situation at the athletic club, that a situation with a prominent, we ain't gonna say it like that. We're just gonna say she's a family member. They just cluing him in that he needs to get to the hospital because one of his loved ones have been injured. So he tries to give Sharon a little spill on it, a little tea, but he really has to go. And she gets upset about it, but she know. She's telling Dylan to tell them, she's gonna keep Abby in their prayers, and hopefully everything turns out for the best with her. So we go back to the hospital. Dr. Neville are sitting in the lobby waiting area by Abby's room, and pretty much Ashley's asking him, what's going on, but he's actually bringing her a cup of coffee to try to soothe her nerves, or fill her stomach up if she hadn't had anything to eat prior to the incident happening. And she thought that was nice, and she thanked him for his hospitality and stuff of that nature, and his caring, concern attitude towards her and the situation she's finding herself in. But she just wanted straight with no chaser what his medical ideal of what he thinks is going to be the turnout of Abby baby, and losing it or not. And he pretty much said, to have the trauma that she had to go through by tumbling down those stairs, it's pretty bleak. It's almost like, no, she's lost the baby. Let's go into that frame of thinking, in that mode. But he gives it to her scientifically and medically sound. And, she was like thanking him for not pussyfooting around and basically just telling her what she wants to hear to make her feel better, even though it may not be the outcome that he knows is, it won't be. So she was okay with that. And I was good. I was liking that point. Just brace her for the worst, and so she can deal on that level. And if it's a miracle that's gonna come out of it, then let's give God the great, the glory for that miracle he did. But he decided not to, because he only got the demon seed running around now. If he didn't get her that time, he's gonna do it to her again. So it's best that we need to handle this little demon child, get some exorcism going on or whatever, because he is truly, 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 truly a bad seed going around and trying to hurt people for an unnecessary reason. So something is definitely going on with him mentally, and we need to figure that out before we put another baby in the equation. Okay. All right. That's where we're going with it. So, then Nick comes to the hospital and addresses Victoria about the comes and goings on the end result of what's going on with their sister. And Victoria says she pretty much don't know. It's basic what she know, but they haven't told us anything. Nobody specifically come out and give us the 411 on her situation and whatnot, at least not at this time. So they're still in wait mode. So he was just going over some things, and he was remembering some things about them losing a baby just recently, him and Sage, and it just brought back too many memories, so he didn't really want to be there either. So, like I said, the doctor said that the baby was dead, pretty much, and that concluded really the whole episode there, because then being initially out there knowing what was what, and they had to take her to, the emergency surgery. He just went on and came out and told the people that that's what's going to transpire. She lost the baby. wasn't successful with keeping it, and they're gonna go clean her up on the inside, and you know, just pray for us pretty much. But y'all, I'm telling you, see, that's almost an hour. It is. It will be an hour that I talk to y'all. And it doesn't take me that long when I'm doing my visuals. But like I said, I wanted to do it for Angela since I guess she wanted to see my facial expressions and my body language or whatnot on camera with me giving my recap and review of my soap operas or reality shows that I am giving to you all each day. So again, that was The Young and the Restless for April 21st, which was Thursday, this past Thursday of last week. So y'all be blessed. See, Angela, I was true to my word. I gave you me on camera. I don't know when next time you're going to see me. So enjoy this one. Keep watching it, whatever. Please tell your friends.